Hello everyone and welcome to the first podcast episode in 2024 of Self-Made Abroad podcast. My name is Stefan Stosic and in today's podcast episode we are going to be talking of life abroad as a personal development and growth. I was thinking who could be my guest. Therefore, I invite Raoni Duran, who is my guest today, and he's a health practitioner focusing on clients who live abroad. Hello Raoni and welcome to Self-Made Abroad podcast.
Hi, thank you.
So as I said, we want to talk about life abroad, which I consider personally that it's a path of personal development and growth. Mm-hmm. But before we dip into those questions and that I'm very interested to hear your answers, I would just like to introduce yourself to our audience, who you are, what you're doing, where you're coming from, and how it happened that actually you're in Berlin doing or working as a health practitioner.
Yeah, sure. So my name is Raoni. I'm coming from Brazil. I've been living in Germany, especially in Berlin, for almost 12 years. Before that, I had some time living in Spain, in Barcelona, which was a very important experience for me. And also at that time, I came to Berlin for the first time and basically fell in love with the city, as many people do. And I wanted to live here. So that's was my experience living abroad. And being a foreigner here and having my life here over these years, most of my friends and people that I get in contact with are also foreigners. So that's how eventually when I decided to work with psychotherapy, I understood that that was a good way to connect both, because it was just part of my world and the things that interest me the most.
Is it psychology? Is it like a specific field that actually coach people on the topics that or challenges that people face by living abroad, right?
Yeah. And also seeing my friends or people that I knew or colleagues who maybe were struggling with different topics about living abroad and living in Berlin. I was wondering, like, how could I support them? How could I help them? And at the time, I would even think, like, how can I help them find a therapy? And I didn't think that I could do it myself until someone told me, well, actually, you could do it yourself. And then I realized, well, actually, I can be the one who also supports people like that.
Okay. And your path of moving abroad, you said that you moved firstly to Spain from Brazil with being 21 years old.
Yes.
And your personal path or your trigger actually of moving and living abroad were studies or just your eagerness to or wish to live abroad? So how this path actually personally developed for you that you do not live in your home country nowadays?
Yeah, I think since I was very young, I had this fascination about going far away and living in another country, a kind of dream. I decided to go to Spain for the first time because it was kind of a moment where I didn't know exactly what to do with my life. And because my family also comes from Spain, I wanted to go there and experience what it would be to live there. So I went there. And then eventually I came to Berlin, and I never thought that I would like Germany or Berlin so much, but I ended up feeling such a vitality and like a energy of just life here that I wanted to also be a part of this Berlin experience.
Now I would say that even though that it sounds nice going from Brazil, Spain, and then coming to Berlin in Germany, I guess, and you mentioned yourself, that that path was not only filled with amazingness, and also you said that your friends were internationals and global, I call them global citizens, mm-hmm. and then you said it yourself that they, as well as you, face some challenges. Do you recall specific moment when you discovered, okay, this challenge was life-changing for me? So I also, some of my friends struggle with XYZ, so I want to help them. And then you went into chiropractic or psychotherapy.
Yeah, so as most people who move abroad, at first, the most important thing was surviving. So just getting a job and paying the bills. And my way through that was that I started working with a company called Get Your Guide, and I eventually became a team lead there. And in a position of a manager, I was also coaching my team, so helping them to work better or dealing with their issues. Of course, that was in a professional sense and not in a personal one. But I realized how much I liked that, how much I like to just help people develop themselves and to coach people. And eventually I thought, well, I would like to do that in a personal sense, that I can work with them further and not just to make them work better, but just to help them to be happier or be better people or their best version of themselves. So that's how I eventually got it. And combined with that, also this kind of desire to help people who are maybe in difficult situations living abroad. Because as you said, it can be difficult. And I guess any place that you go has their challenges. In Berlin, sometimes is the loneliness because you don't have a network of support, or it's a very hedonistic city, so you can get kind of lost in the party scene too. And this also has consequences. So I was thinking, how can I do that? So combining my experience with like coaching people in my previous job, and then also seeing the need for someone who also speaks English or works primarily in English, because some of my friends were also struggling to find a therapist who not only speaks English but also understands their experience. That's how I figured out that I could combine all these elements.
So basically it means that in the path of finding yourself, like you did one job, you were observing yourself in what you like, what you dislike, and this is actually how you came up with that, that actually you're interested in personal development and growth yourself, but also other people.
Yeah.
And you came into psychotherapy. But something I noticed for me personally is also a process.
Mm-hmm.
It's also a path. It's not easy
exactly.
done. It's not like one moment, one day, one week. And this is something that me personally gives a lot of struggle, mental struggle, emotional struggle. And then my question to you is like, when we think that yeah, it is a path, it is a process. And then I think of, yeah, I wish that I knew X, Y, Z when I was 21, 22, 23, compared to some years later. And then it comes with negative feelings or, I don't know, anxiety or frustration. Why? How I could have not known that before? But actually you cannot. So what's your point on that? To see that you do need to spend some effort, you do need to spend some time to discover something you like.
Well, something that I keep seeing either with my clients or with studying and seeing this experience of living abroad is that it looks and it feels like something that you're doing outside. And it is, of course, you're going to another country, you're having an experience in a completely different environment, and you're putting yourself out in the world. That's very exciting. And also it feels like you're just going out, you know? And it is like that because especially in the beginning, it is all about finding a place to live. It's about finding new people, discovering your life in this new environment. And that's a very important element of the experience. But as you go, you start to see that it becomes, or it is was from the beginning, a very interior experience as well. This journey that felt like going abroad and going far actually is happening inside of you, most importantly. And after a while that you're already overseas or you're having these experiences, then you start to see the changes inside of yourself. Of course, this was in the beginning, but you only realize that this was happening after a while, because in the beginning, the outside is so exciting and there's so many elements that it's kind of hypnotizing.
Yes. So basically you want to say that you cannot see looking here forward, but only from here backward. So it means that you get some meaning out of your experience only once you leave them and you look backward actually, and you, okay, that makes sense. That's why I felt like this, like that, in order to discover X, Y, Z.
Yeah.
Okay, so it's a necessary thing to go through in order to find yourself, let's say.
I think so. I think all these experiences, they point to something inside of yourself too, and they help you in your personal transformation. So this experience may feel like very exterior, very like you're doing something out in the world, but they're also causing something inside of you. So I think that's an interesting connection to from the outside and the inside, but they're actually working together.
What kind of struggles people face when they leave abroad, when they change their environment, circle of friends, they face many challenges, visible and invisible ones. Visible like bureaucracy or, I don't know, achievements on papers or whatever. But I want to ask you, what kind of challenges do people face inner challenges when it comes to emotional and mental fear?
I think the first thing would be that when you go to a different country, especially if you go by yourself, you don't have any network of support. Like, of course, if you're in an underprivileged situation, you can also already come from a very low kind of support in your original place. But when you have family or kind of network in your country of origin or your place of origin, and you go to a different place, you don't have that anymore. So all your needs or any negative thing that can happen to you, you have to deal by yourself. That's a big challenge because...
So that's like independence, let's say.
Yeah, and that's interesting because it's a double side, right? Because you may feel very alone or like nobody is helping you. You have to do it by yourself. But at the same time, you're independent. You're free to do whatever you want and find your own way. And then it will come very much to your own personal constitution to deal with that. Some people just blossom and they figure out how to do that, or they are lucky and they do it amazingly. And other people, maybe they already had other struggles. Maybe they have a kind of trauma that makes it difficult for them to deal with these difficulties. So they can get kind of stuck or get into a kind of habit or behavior that is more destructive for them, which makes it more difficult to live this life. So.
Okay, I see. So everyone has their own path and the way they deal with the situation. So
yeah.
Positive thing would be you get to be independent. However, it has some costs, like... leaving some human experience such as negative emotions. So what would you say?
The interesting thing is that my clients, when they come to me and we start to work together, even though they are people who are living away from their place of origin, I would not say that they have problems that only people who live abroad have.
Okay.
They have normal issues that people in any place or any country would be. And that's an element. They are also not in their place of origin, which also has consequences. But they come with normal issues, depression, anxiety, trauma, all the things that we hear about or we know about everywhere. So it's an element of their experience that they're living abroad. And it's important that I'm aware of that and I understand from my personal experience.
One question that gets on my mind now is, does it mean that actually if I live abroad, and for example, from my personal experience, I did, it would have been easier if I was in my home country. It would have been XYZ if I was in my home country. And then you said now that actually people living abroad, they do face some challenges, but actually it's not only unique to us as expats, as global citizens. So then how do you treat, or how do you relate, or you're a bridge in your therapy with your clients to bridge those differences among people, but still not apply one size fits all?
Part of my training and my general attitude when I'm working with my clients is that, of course, everyone is unique. And my approach is that when I'm having a session with someone, I don't come with all the answers, all the solutions. I'm there to understand the person, to try to see things from their perspective, and also they're the ones who are going to find the solutions and to find their answers. So my process is much more to think about things together with you, to kind of understand, to ask the right questions, and to help my clients see from them for themselves what is the way that they want to take. I cannot say that I know you better than you know yourself. I may have a lot of different sessions with you, but you have been living with yourself for your whole life. So who am I to say that I know the answer of what you should do? Giving advice is something that I would prefer not to do in my work in therapy. It's much more exciting to help you find your own answer and seeing that happen in front of me.
Okay, I see. Yeah, thank you for this. And one part that you mentioned now is like, you know who you are. However, from my personal experience, I know that at some point of being abroad and living abroad is that you wake up, you think about your past XYZ years, and you think, who am I? What am I doing? I would say that this is particularly when you finish one stage of your life, such as studies, and you moved abroad, and now it comes career. But you need to ask yourself, what do I like to do?
Mm-hmm.
And you maybe have couple of internships. You worked some small job in the past years. But part of that is that when you ask yourself what I like to do, what I would like to work, it's a blank. It's an empty line. And you say now, yes, you are the one who is going to fill it in. That sure completely agree with that. However, let's say writing those letters on that line, which takes like in personal life months, years of discovering who I want to be in the end, it takes some time. But writing it, it takes like 1 or 2 seconds. So let's say when you compare it to living such a kind of experience and writing that, that not everyone, including myself, knew in the past, who am I? So when people come to you and they live abroad and say, yes, I moved with this kind of desire, with this kind of goal, and I achieved it, but I do not feel content, or I do not feel happy, or I achieved and then I was happy, but now there is another challenge in front of me, makes me feel, I don't know who am I anymore. What do you say then? And how do you see, how would you approach this? Or what would you say to people who have similar problems and they are watching or listening to this podcast?
I think that's where the kind of magic of therapy or coaching happens, is because, as you said, to say you know who you are, that's just an expression, but who we are is something that changes all the time as well. So I think the magic and what happens is that we start to see the different elements of each person. So like, what are their motivations? What are their feelings? Not just emotional feelings, but also physical feelings. What have been their experiences? What are their relationships? What is their history? And trying to pick all those elements together and see what is really relevant for the person. Of course, every person comes with a demand. They come with an issue that they want to work with or something that is troubling them. So of course, we focus on that. But all these elements, everything that constitutes them as a person, are important for that as well. So that's how I approach it.
So basically it's like coaching with people, but also letting them think and building many important areas for themselves that you build, which is actually what's important to us. It's actually something that makes us as people and defines, like, makes the definition of us who we are.
Yeah.
Okay. And now when you think, because you said that people living abroad, they do not face some aliens level of problems, or so basically all of us have also same issues, and there are people living in home country as well. But when it comes to people living abroad, and you mentioned earlier that is when you move, basically, especially as a student, that the goal is to survive and actually work towards your goal. So I would say that not many people actually pay attention to coaching and therapy. And two biggest benefits for me are two levels, which is mental and emotional state of people. What are the challenges for people living abroad in another country with another local language that they maybe not speak to get to some coaches and get some therapy and coaching from your point of view as a coach?
As we were talking, people go abroad, they have this amazing experience or a difficult experience. And at some point, I think a lot of people get to a more stable level where maybe they already achieved something and they are a bit more settled in that experience as well, if they don't come back to their place of origin. Especially in those moments, some things can start to come up. Especially with trauma, there is this recognition that the kind of symptoms of trauma start to appear, especially when people are more stable. When life seems to be okay, they have the family, the job, that's when things start to come up, because the mind has this capacity of like almost putting things in an archive, because it knows you cannot deal with that right now. So it keeps it for later, for the moment when you have more capacity to look into them. So a lot of people, after they are in a more stable situation, they start to feel that something is not right. Something is missing, or is bothering them. It can be even disturbing. And that's when they start to feel like, I need to look into this. And maybe they don't even know how to. And that's when they start to think that maybe therapy would be a good reason, a good way to deal with this.
So it means that with the safe, let's say when we satisfy these like achieving something that we were chasing after or we've been after, it means that comes now with all these traumas and unhealed stuff that start to appear on the surface.
Exactly. Before, you wouldn't even have time or mental capacity to look into something deeper because you had to take care of your studies, to take care of your job. You know, we're talking about survival. So all these different things that are about surviving, when you're preoccupied with that, it's very difficult to look deeper or to even notice that there's something else. Maybe it's already bothering you, but you don't have time or capacity to look into that. That's why it's normally in these moments of more tranquility that things start to come up.
Okay, when, I guess maybe you yourself, like you in your own personal experience, you had this, okay, I still need to finish this and then I'm gonna be happy. I still need to finish that and I'm gonna be better. I still need to, I don't know, learn German and improve being C1 and then everything is gonna be perfect. I still need to change my job and get my permanent residence and I'm gonna be safe, I'm gonna be happy, whatever. I still need to get nationality, passport or whatever, so I'm safe. So when, where is the secret or where is like to feel right now content or feel contentment and feel happy and feeling enough without being, when I do that, I will be XYZ.
From my experience working with my clients, I guess the dynamic that happens is a little bit different because they normally come with an issue, with something that is bothering them. And as you're saying, maybe even this feeling of like, I always have to get something, there's always a next step and it's never enough. That's already something that is causing some suffering, you know, because you feel like it's never enough and I'm always like in this hamster wheel, as they're saying. That's already an issue. When you have something that is bothering you and is already causing suffering, even though it is difficult, it's already a way, you know, it's already pointing to something that is unsatisfying for you. So just the fact that you look into that is already, I think, a way forward, because you're not ignoring, you're not pretending it doesn't exist or like going to a different direction. You're looking into it, and that's already a way to find something about it. And when I work with my clients, most of the time what we find out is that this has much deeper implications and it means much more than what it looks from the surface. So they might come with a depression or a feeling that they went through a traumatic experience or anything else. And as we work together, we find out that there is other needs that were not met or other desires or other things that are important for them. And then when you address those things or you just give light by talking about it, there is already a healing about it.
Okay.
And you see things changing. When you are in therapy, the therapist is just there really to support you. They're not there to heal you because the only one that can heal yourself is you. You know, it happens inside of you and the brain works in their own mysterious ways. So you see that happening with clients that they start to feel better or to improve or to have less of those complaints that they had in the beginning. But I was there just supporting, and something happened inside of them that even I don't know exactly how it happened. I was there kind of side by side with them.
Yes, I completely get your point and agree completely with that, that only ones that can help ourselves are is us, actually.
Yeah.
So it means that if you pay a personal trainer or the gym, they will help you and they will do their professional work to help you with the advices, with the exercises and so on. But they cannot come and shut the door on your fridge to not take something that they told you that you should not be eating. So we think that one thing is a problem of living abroad, not having support network and so on. But actually you said that in conversation with your clients, you come actually to the field of unsatisfied needs that actually by satisfying them, first thinking about them, which is the first step, actually being aware, identifying them, and then taking action to satisfy those, which then influence actually getting higher quality of life, which in the end heals trauma or heals like some of your experience or the way you see things. So from this elaboration from your side, I understand that coaching is really important. However, what I see in even in Berlin and my circle of friends, coaching is not very widely spread, and psychotherapy. So my question is, if emotional and mental health of people, not only expats and people living abroad, is important, why not so many people actually pay attention to that, or they do not openly talk about that?
I believe it's a combination of different things. First, I would say is a cultural thing. If we think even about the generation of our parents or our great-grandparents, there was no talk about psychotherapy. There was no talk about mental health or self-improvement. This is something that, of course, is as already one century, if we talk about Freud or psychoanalysis. But the becoming more mainstream and that people are aware of this, are interested in this, this is something more recent. And the newer generations are more open to realize, oh, actually, this issue could be something psychological or something emotional, and I can deal with that in that way, instead of looking for something external to kind of put a band-aid on it. So that's a difficulty, but I think it's already positive because it's changing and it's becoming more available, or it's not such a taboo for people, because psychological issues could be like a disease, mm-hmm. how it was seen before. But in another sense, it's also difficult, because when you deal with personal problems or issues that are related to your history or difficulties, it takes courage to look into that, and it kind of stirs things inside of you, and that can also be difficult. Even just to remember difficult experiences, to talk about it with someone, they have to trust me, they have to feel that they can talk to me about it and open up to someone else. Maybe they don't want to talk to anyone about it. And it's just difficult to deal with psychological issues or our own inner problems. Some people are great. They love going deep and talking about their deep issues. Other people feel very uncomfortable to go deep and talk about the sides of themselves that maybe they don't like so much. They prefer to have a very happy face and just go through life.
You said at one point that some people do not like to go deep, or it's very uncomfortable for them. Mm. So one part of living abroad and facing with many challenges, I would say, if I could describe it under one word, would be discomfort.
Mm-hmm.
So when you say, okay, that yeah, it's great to develop as humans, it's great to develop as our individuals, like as individual, like and be better version, stronger version of ourselves. However, it's filled with path full of discomfort.
Mm-hmm.
And when I would think about that, I would ask, then isn't it a solution to go back to your home country? Then you don't need to learn German language. Then you don't need to face rude people in immigration office. You don't need to search and make interviews in English or German language. Many things are gone.
Yeah.
If the solution is so easy, why still so many people, expats, decide to stay in a foreign country instead of going back home?
Of course, that has as many answers as there are expats in the world. But if you talk about the question of discomfort, it's being researched that when we, as they say, go out of our comfort zone, we have this feeling of discomfort because we are trying something that we are not used to, and maybe we don't know about that. So it causes discomfort. But that's also the way that we grow, because eventually we kind of open our horizon, we expand the things we can do, the things we know, and then we have this feeling it becomes less uncomfortable, and at some point we feel like, actually, I'm good in what before I couldn't do. And that's the moment where we feel like, actually, I grew with this experience, I became somehow different, maybe even better, depending on how I qualify it. So I think a lot of people look for that experience. They want to somehow grow. They want to have different experiences. They want to go to a different direction. And I think a lot of expats, they look for that experience. Other people, they don't even have the luxury. They're forced to go overseas because there's something in their origin that doesn't allow them to stay there. They have to escape, or a very bad situation in their origin. So it can also be an escape. And then it's also difficult for them in that sense. If someone is very comfortable in their place of origin and they have no desire to grow, they're very satisfied with their life, they're just not gonna go to a different country.
Yes.
They're gonna be satisfied.
So what's the difference? And I would say, yes, staying and living abroad is part of personal development and growth. Mm-hmm. However, I would say that people as humans naturally grow and develop. Mm-hmm. Being abroad or not.
Yeah.
So the difference is only maybe in the desire or what to differentiate among people who want to go abroad or who not.
That's something that I think sometimes too, because for example, even the term expat means someone who moved to a different country. But I think about this as someone who just moved to a different city or a different region in their own country. That experience, I believe, can be as intense as someone who moved to a different country, because they also change to a different place, and they also maybe don't have their context and their network of support, and they have to start from scratch in another place. If you think about a big country like the United States or Brazil, this can be very real. So of course, people are transforming and growing in different ways, and we cannot even judge someone who never leaves their hometown. Exactly. Because maybe their way of growing is by forming a family, for example. Maybe they dreamed since they were a child to have a wife and kids or husband. And for them, just creating that reality for them is that the way that they're going to grow. So maybe we look at them and we see like, oh, maybe that's not the life that I wanted to live and I needed to go far away. But maybe for them, that's the greatest growth that they could have.
And in that case, let's say that you have two people, like two persons, mm-hmm. and person A is someone who wants to go abroad for studies, career, whatever. And person B is someone who already lives abroad. Both of them will feel fear, insecurity, or usually negative human emotions. So what would be your advices, or how you would different, like, let's say someone, I'm a client and I'm calling you from my home country for people, and you're a therapist for people living abroad. Mm. So I would ask you some questions, but my questions would be towards emotional fear. Mm. However, someone who already lives abroad, achieved, I don't know, diploma that he or she wanted to achieve, mm. but still there are some other levels. So it's again fear of or insecurity about unknown.
Yeah.
And still when you look at the surface, the emotion is the same, but they're on this different level. Mm. So what kind of advices you would give to people who A, want to move abroad, but they are in home country and they know that this is their mm. desire and their wish, but they are insecure about their steps.
Mm.
And B, to people who already live abroad, but they still face some challenges.
Yeah. In general, I think the way that I would look at this is that someone who is still, who hasn't taken that step yet, I would imagine that their fears and anxieties are a lot about taking this kind of leap of faith and jumping into something that they have no idea what's going to happen. So I would imagine that their fears and anxieties are about, what's going to happen with me? Why am I doing this?
Exactly.
So I would
are the questions that appear in our mind. Yeah.
I would work with like trying to find out what are their motivations? What is pulling them to have this experience? Why do you want to do this? And then work through that. Someone who is already having that experience has been, as we said, a bit more stable. I would imagine that they are a bit more familiar with their fears and anxieties. They know a little bit more when it happens, why, or maybe not why, but what are they? It's not so much jumping into the unknown. It's already something that they have more familiarity with.
Let's say I have someone who is my client and he wants to move abroad. However, he is very indecisive because he has a job in home country and he knows that he wants to improve and move abroad from whichever reason. Yeah. So what would you say for these stuck people, like people who are stuck with their decision making and they go back and forth and they're considering taking studies abroad, taking the job abroad for a year or two, but you, of course, something changed, but still the result of them leaving and moving abroad is not happening yet. So what would you say are the triggers, or what are those barriers that actually prevent them to finally achieve that?
So someone like that, I imagine, knows very well what are the two sides of the decision.
All right.
They know what speaks for it and they know what doesn't speak for it. My work with them would be to maybe expand the perspective or to go deeper and to understand what is holding up these indecisions. What are the feelings that they're having? What are the connections that they have? What is their history telling them? Because we can get stuck in this kind of like, should I do it? Should I not do it? I'll get this and that. And then you don't pay attention to what is holding up these two teams, let's say. All your history, all your motivations, all your feelings, things that you might not be aware. For example, someone who is afraid of losing their stability and losing their job.
Exactly.
That's easy to understand. However, what maybe the person doesn't know and I don't know is why for you it's so important to have stability. What is the meaning for you to have stability, to have a job? It's not the same for everyone. So I would investigate with them, why do you have this stability? Why do you want to have it? Why is it so important for you? And then on the other side, what are you looking for? And then going deeper into that. And then when those things are more clarified, people eventually by themselves are going to find out, okay, I know the risks, I know what I want, and then I can make a decision with a bit more awareness.
I would say somehow, or again, I would connect it to human needs. Like if stability, like safety is like the basic need of, or like after physiological needs, like of hunger and so on, then you have safety.
Yeah.
So job maybe is safety, my safety that I get income, that I could afford myself food.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, could be, okay, it means like moving abroad means that I may need to learn new things. I may lose job I have here or the position I have at the university offered here. So it means again, comes to getting to know more of particular needs of that person and importance of those needs for that particular person.
Yeah, and it's different from everyone. That reminds me of a time when I had a flatmate and I was very worried about my job situation or my stability. And I was telling her about it and she was like, I think I asked her like how she coped with that for herself. And she was kind of like, well, something is going to come up. I'm going to figure out eventually. And that's it. That's the way that she lived her life. So for her, the way that she lived stability and she looked for it was different than mine. And in that moment, I realized like, okay, I'm freaking out about this, but there's someone who has a different perspective. So that was a moment that I learned something. And when you do therapy, maybe you clarify those things for people as well.
Yes, but in that case, isn't it like moving abroad also comes with different perspectives of people?
Yeah.
And you said here stability. For you, stability was definition one. For your flatmate was definition two.
Yeah.
However, you see that both of you, stability perceives in a different way.
Yeah.
But also itself, like how you behave in life. So it means understanding, and I would say that self-development of living abroad comes from understanding yourself more.
Yeah, I think it's a powerful experience because of that too, because it takes you out so much of your comfort zone, and because not only you're doing that by yourself, but also you're getting so much different perspectives from different people and a different culture, you're constantly looking at those things, you're constantly confronted with them. So I think that's why we grow so fast with this experience, because you're constantly being confronted and taking out of your comfort, learning with different people, having a different experience, or seeing how I react to all of this. It's very difficult to be stable in a, like, and not change with all of this. It just happens because you're in the middle of this hurricane.
One, now as I'm listening to you and you're Heilpraktiker in German or health practitioner or therapist, and then you're coaching people living abroad, you yourself live abroad. And then a thought that comes to my mind is like, oh, this guy has everything figured out. Like, so. So then it's like, you know, like when it's like kids in school, you know, like when a teacher teaches you mathematics or something and then you cannot figure it out. Oh, I wish that I am my teacher because then I would know this. So the way I see it, this thought, I just caught it now when I was listening to you. This guy has everything figured out. What would you say on this?
No, I don't. part of being a therapist is also working with your own personal things. When you are working with people, it's a human thing that I'm also learning with you, and I'm also sometimes triggered by something. So the moment that you are a therapist, is also advised that you do your own therapy. And not only that, that you also do supervision, which is having a more experienced therapist guide you through your process. So I haven't figured everything out, and I also go through my own process. It's a continuing thing. But I love that process, and that's why I like to work with this, because I love the process with myself, and I love to be with other people when they're going through theirs.
And how then you deal with the negative emotions when you have anxiety or frustration in achieving goal, in finding who you are, to define something?
So from my personal point of view, I think like anyone else, I have moments where I'm also lost, where like I'm feeling bad and I have no idea why, and I cannot shake out this feeling. Of course I have that. I think I'm also always trying to figure out why and what's happening and paying attention. So I try to pay attention to what I'm feeling. I try to think about the causes or something that happened. I try to make the connections. I do my own therapy. So if I'm really stuck, then my therapist is also probably going to help me to figure out. But it's also a kind of something you develop, almost like a muscle. The more you work with your inner issues, the easier it gets to figure them out. Not entirely, because it never ends, but to not get stuck for so long. So instead of maybe losing a whole year with one issue, I can maybe figure out in a couple of months.
Okay.
So like I have my own therapist, but also I'm part of the process. So I'm also, with his help, figure out my own things.
Okay.
So someone who does therapy or even just working in their self-development, I guess they would say that with some time, it gets easier because they know the resources that they have and they know how to look for the answers.
So what are the tools that you would recommend to people who live in a different country, in a foreign country, and they have what kind of challenge they face?
Some of the tools maybe are, they sound so obvious, but I think they're very important. So the first one that comes to mind is rest. So I think nowadays a lot of people are aware of how important it is to sleep. Mm-hmm. We live in a world that is full of light, that is getting our attention all the time. So finding some way that you can rest, maybe even sleep is difficult, and you need to figure out how you can find some rest by lying down or having a moment for yourself. It can be so difficult because, as I said, we're getting this call for attention all the time. But it's so important because even when you start therapy with someone, some of the first questions that I have to ask is like, how are you doing with your sleep? How you're doing with your nutrition? Do you exercise? The most basic things, because we can go very far and go into your childhood and your traumas. But if you're not sleeping well, it's just going to make everything more difficult. So maybe going back to the basics, like just taking care that you can sleep well or at least have moments of rest, that you eat as healthy as you can or enjoy food in a positive way without being compulsive, maybe exercise as well. But maybe going back to these basics, because sometimes we can look for very fancy problems, mm-hmm. but our problems are very fundamental. It's about our body and how we feel. It doesn't mean that if you have a good night of sleep, your problems are going to disappear.
Yeah, these are my expectations.
But if you rest well, then maybe it's easier to look at what exactly is happening. Maybe that bad feeling you were having that you cannot shake that I mentioned, maybe it was because you're hungry and you didn't realize that you needed to eat something. So it's just like when you want to deal with your issues, it's important that you first check that the basic things are covered, because then if they are covered and they're okay, then maybe there's something else. But then in that moment, you also have more capacity to look into them.
And now, as if I ask you as Raoni Duran, who has experience as an international, so what would you say that are the biggest benefits of your path of living abroad for the past 12 years?
Yeah, I think it's very personal, but for me, it's just the freedom that I had to really create my own path as well. When I left my home country, I also, as everyone, left a network of support, which I'm very thankful that I had. But the liberty, the freedom to find my own way, to figure out what I wanted to do, and to create the life that I wanted to live, is the biggest benefit, because I'm super happy that I did it and with the life that I have. So that's personally for me the biggest benefit. I didn't know when I left Brazil all the experience that I was gonna have and who I was going to become, what was gonna happen with me. It's not that I like said no to everything that was behind me, and I knew exactly. It's kind of like this thing of like, I'm here in the world, let's see what's gonna happen, and learning how to be open and to be open to the world, open to people, and going with what's happening.
Okay.
I think that's the biggest learning.
And then in the end, everything goes, like, if I can summarize, in two things that I notice is like self-awareness and need satisfaction. If I could summarize it in two ways, it's like a path that I could see from our conversation that goes to more fulfilling life. Again, it requires time, it's a process.
Mm.
But then I would say, if then I see that coaching and therapy is important, and still what we said, and that people do not pay attention or they do not open and talk about that.
Mm.
So as a therapist, as a coach, as a health practitioner, what is the procedure, actually, we live in Berlin, in Germany, for someone who is an expat and they want to get coaching and to get, like, let's say they want to work with you. So what is the process actually to get you as a coach?
Germany has, in a way, a very good system if you compare it to other countries. Of course, it's not perfect, but it's a system where people can get a psychotherapy with the health system that they already pay into. That's the difficult part of that system, is that there's so much demand for psychotherapy, and not, well, there are enough therapists for that, but the way that they're assigned and who gets them can be very tricky. So a lot of people keep looking for therapy or
exactly.
therapists, and they cannot find.
Exactly.
Or they want like a longer term, they cannot get just a couple of sessions. It's complicated. I work in the private kind of system. So if people come to me, unfortunately, they are not reimbursed. It's not for free because of their health care system. They have to pay privately. But that also allows me to have more independence, and for them to, for me to be more available for them. It's not so difficult to get a session with me.
Therapy and coaching is important on one hand, and for mental and emotional health of people.
Yeah.
On the other side, you have prices, and you have people that they do not feel secure due to the income they are receiving, and so on. So what's the bridge between those two things, like between those two extremes, and what are actually the pricing? What could people, like, what kind of range could people like expect for a therapy session with therapists?
It's something that I also wonder often, not about the prices, but about how the system could be better. So in general, I would say the kind of minimum price that you would have for a private session here in Berlin would be like 60 euros. Then it goes up from that. Normally it's more like 80. If you have a coach, it can be, I heard that coaches are normally more than 100. So it varies. As you said, it is an investment. I do my own therapy, which I pay privately, and I feel like that's an important thing to do, because I'm investing in myself, and I feel like it's important. If someone doesn't have the ability to do that, they cannot pay. As we said, there are other resources, journaling, there are different systems. But I think even as a society, we haven't found the answer for that yet, because I believe that at some point, if we continue to evolve as a civilization, I think taking care of mental health is just going to be something as normal as like taking a shower or eating is something that everyone would be able to do. And for that to be able to happen, I think we have to develop better systems so that not only the people who can pay should do it, It's something that I think about often, like how could I help that become a reality? But I don't know yet how. But I hope that that's the way that we're going, because I can see the benefit for the people that I work with, and just in general also for myself.
If people want to work with you, how they can reach out to you, where they can find you.
So I have my website that is my name, haonidudan.com. There you can find the information about me. You can also book a session if you want. I have a calendar there where you can book. You can also contact me if you have any questions, and want to clarify something, we can talk. So that's the easiest way, I guess. I'm also in social media, in Instagram, for example, also haonidudan, just my name. And besides that, I'm in some other platforms that have therapists available here in Berlin and abroad. So,
Okay. Anyways, I will put all your contacts in the show notes so people can directly click and reach out to you. I must thank you for this podcast episode. It's the
thank you.
first one in this year, and challenges and life abroad and personal development is very important topic, and I would say for most of the people, actually experiences and developing as humans, it's one of the biggest triggers and like motivation actually to go abroad. And that's why I wanted to get someone that comes from professional and personal with personal and professional experience actually to share thoughts on that. So thank you so much for this.
Thank you too for the opportunity, and I'm happy to talk.
Thank you very much everyone for watching this podcast episode. Until next time, kind regards from Berlin. Bye.